Well, that's a very British metaphor, a British trope. But my guest today and I both know the American versions of that trope. We are both go way back in the world of newspapers and have gone off in other directions recently, or not so recently in my case. But yeah, you know, you work for a newspaper, people are telling you all the time. They're going to wrap the fish tomorrow. They're going to line the bird cage with the stuff that you put your heart and soul into working on. We're going to talk. This is one of the shows that we're doing in this election season where we have one guest, and we're going to do a kind of a deeper dive into that person's thoughts. Today, that guest is Mark Jacob, who writes the weekly newsletter Stop the Presses. He is a former Metro editor of the Chicago Tribune, former Sunday editor of the Chicago Sun-Times, also the co-author of 10 books on history and photography. Mark Jacob, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So I've been reading your stuff for a long time, and I agree with an awful lot of it. One of the things that I do when I'm teaching, which I'm probably all done doing at this point, but every year I ask myself if I have a definition of journalism that will stand up, that is something that we can kind of measure things purporting to be journalism against. And I'm wondering if you have the same thing, if you have a working definition of what journalism is.
Well, I think you can say that journalism is telling the public the truth as you know it, based on the evidence you have, and making that the sole motivation. You know, you're not trying to get somebody elected. You're not, you know, trying to make money. You're trying to get the truth to the public. And one of the things that I like to talk about is the value added of journalism. And I like to say that just turning the microphones on and letting people talk is not journalism. You know, that's a machine can do that. Journalism is finding statistics. It's looking at the past of votes of a politician. It's talking to experts. It's going and talking to the regular people who are affected by governmental policies. It's doing real work. It's journalism. That's what the value added of journalism is. And if you think that journalism is just turning on the microphones and letting people talk, then you're just not doing it.
Yeah. My most recent definition is journalism gives people an actionable picture of reality, that it is an attempt to give people an actionable portrait of reality. But I'm going to just pounce on what you just said here, because this will be fun for the two of us to unpack. Let's do an example of just turning the microphones on. On September 20th, on Bill Maher's show, where, in fact, that's what they do, they turn the microphones on a regular basis, and people with varying degrees of expertise talk about subjects. You're going to hear an exchange between Bret Stephens, one of the New York Times' more conservative columnists, and MSNBC's Stephanie Ruhle. And I should also say that this is preceded by something that, you know, various sides have been working the refs about a lot, and that is how often Kamala Harris should sit for interviews, who she should sit for interviews with. And so Stephens says, you know, there's so many things we don't know about that she needs to be asked about. He gives an example, I think, of would she support a Palestinian state if it meant that Hamas would run it? And Stephanie Ruhle counters, and this kind of went viral, she's not running for perfect, she's running for president, kind of sets the idea in motion that her main job is to beat Trump because Trump is so dangerous. But let's hear a little bit more of that exchange between Stephens and Ruhle. This is A1 Maestro.
People also are expected to have some idea of what the program is of the person you're supposed to vote for. You're just not supposed to say, well, you have to vote for Y because X is this, that, and the other. Let's find out a little bit more. And I don't think it's a lot to ask her to sit down for a real interview as opposed to a puff piece in which she describes like her feelings of growing up in Oakland with nice lawns.
Then I would just say to that, when you move to Nirvana, give me your real estate broker's number and I'll be your next door neighbor. We don't live there.
So, Mark, I think we could both agree that things where the audience is laughing and there's a comedian and, you know, it wouldn't be out of place or unusual if the other person, the other guest on the show that night was Ben Affleck. It wasn't in this case, but that's not unusual for Maher's program. But there are people kind of committing things that almost resemble acts of journalism there. So just unpack what you just heard a little bit. What do you hear here and what are your thoughts about it?
Well, this whole argument that Kamala Harris is not released details of her policy, I think, is ridiculous and overblown. You get it from people like the New York Times, which desperately wants to do a sit-down interview with Kamala Harris. And so whenever she does a sit-down interview with somebody else, they've got to, you know, they've got to slam it, you know, which they did in the one that happened yesterday with Rule. They, you know, if you read the New York Times story today about the Rule interview yesterday, you know, it's just, it's pretty much saying, this interview sucked. This interview sucked. You know, it's very self-important and very self-interested by the New York Times, in my opinion. And it's not just them. My feeling is that a lot of the political press likes politicians to talk a lot, because when they talk a lot, they slip up, they have gaffes, they go down blind alleys, they say things that they didn't mean to say. And that's news. That's news to them. You know, you had a Politico headline recently that was complaining because Kamala Harris stayed on her talking points during an interview. You know, and that's what real politicians do, what responsible politicians, they pick out what they want to talk about and they talk about it. And, you know, they don't like talk about, you know, Hannibal Lecter and sharks. And so my feeling about that is that it was just kind of cheap and unfair criticism, okay, especially when you – yeah, go ahead.
Well, let me just jump in here. First of all, I mean, I tend to agree with you about stuff, but I will be occasionally on this show today playing devil's advocate or something along those lines. So let's talk about a couple of other things that are happening there. One of the things that Rule is making clear on the Maher show is that she's very, very, very pro-Harris. That's not a big surprise, that she maybe is even willing to cut Harris a little slack because she thinks the really important job is beating Trump. So yeah, 5 days later, I don't know whether there's a relationship between these two events. She does get an interview with Harris.
Right.
Let's hear a little bit of that. This is A2 Maestro.
Over the last 4 years, there have been tremendous economic wins, and you've just laid out a big plan. But still, polling shows that most likely voters still think Donald Trump is better to handle the economy. Why do you think that is?
Well, here's what I know in terms of the facts. Donald Trump left us with the worst economy since the Great Depression, when you look at, for example, the employment numbers.
It was during COVID, and employment was so high because we shut down the government, we shut down the country.
Even before the pandemic, he lost manufacturing jobs by most people's estimates, at least 200,000. He lost manufacturing plants. Ask the auto workers how he lost auto plants. We have grown over 20 new auto plants.
So this is kind of interesting. They're each kind of fact-checking the other, but I don't know. First of all, just give me your overall reaction to this sequence.
Well, I think that Stephanie Ruhle is – I mean, I think she is supporting Harris. I think that she thinks that Harris is better for the country, and she's not pretending otherwise. To me, that's a completely rational view. And Kamala Harris is a politician. I mean, you know, she doesn't really answer that question. Because the question was really, why do people think that Trump's economy would be better than yours? And frankly, the real answer would be a little critical of the American public and their consumption of lies and disinformation. And I don't think she wants to go there. She's doing a politic thing instead, repeating why, you know, the Trump economy wasn't as good as he touts it, and why the Biden Harris economy is better than it's touted. So she's just, I think it's a political answer. I don't think it's a terrible answer, but it's, she didn't really answer the question. And you're not going to get she's a politician. She's going to give political answers, and she's not going to veer off into crazy stuff. And she's not going to do hate talk like her opponent is.
So one of the things that I think would be a mistake for us to do, and would also probably lose us a lot of the audience, is be a couple of old guys saying, well, back in the day, it was like this. But I'm going to break my own rule right now and say, you know, look, you and I remember a time when the person who might do that interview would be, I don't know, Mike Wallace. And Mike Wallace would come in there with no particular declared political interest. He might ask somewhat harder questions. He certainly wouldn't be on a kind of quasi-entertainment faux journalism show 5 days earlier, possibly even, and I don't think this is a far-fetched thing to say, maybe even auditioning to get that interview. I mean, journalists have always done things to get the interview, but it seems to me we're living in a moment right now where you know, that kind of interview that you and I were used to at one point, where there was no declared preference at the beginning and probably no perceived preference at the end. It seems like it just doesn't really happen very much anymore.
No, that's true. I mean, it's all media has become much more overtly partisan, which to me isn't totally a terrible thing. If everyone is disclosing, you know, what their subjective views are. I mean, I kind of feel like that there was a lot of pretense of objectivity in the past that wasn't real objectivity. I'm for journalists being honest about where their biases lay. And, you know, so that's not terrible. But I think what you're getting at, Colin, is the whole idea of how newsmakers are shopping the news reporters, you know, mm-hmm. and picking and choosing. Trump's been doing that, you know, since day one.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's this idea that Harris committed some crime by, you know, having Stephanie Ruhle interview her is kind of silly, even though that's what J.D. Vance was saying yesterday.
And I would never go along with that. Although I do think, I want to get to Trump in just a second here, because this, I think one of the things he's doing is very interesting. Yeah, I don't think that Kamala Harris is committing any crime by looking for, you know, somebody who's going to be relatively sympathetic but not absurdly fawning. I think that's probably the sweet spot she should look for. I'm a little bit more concerned about us as a profession doing our job in that situation. And I think another thing that I've been thinking a lot about, Mark, is whether it's even clear anymore who's doing journalism and when people are committing acts that resemble acts of journalism, whether they – I mean, for example, is Oprah Winfrey a journalist? She's another person who's interviewed Kamala Harris. I think, in Michigan after the debate and was hosted on the PBS NewsHour YouTube page, which makes you think, well, it must be news. I don't know. Is Oprah Winfrey a journalist? She interviews a lot of newsmakers.
Yeah, she is. I think she's interviewing people. She's asking questions about facts. So I think she is. She's not an objective one. Mm. Colin, I got to tell you that I feel like the whole model of journalism was just thrown into a ditch by the Trump candidacy in you know, 2015. I mean, you had this guy who showed up who's constantly lying. I mean, just that's what he does is lie. And the news media, including me, were very used to treating opposing candidates as equals. And in fact, that was a safe space for journalists.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, for example, when I was editing Page One stories for the Chicago Tribune, I used to count the number of Republicans and Democrats in the story, mm-hmm. make sure we had an equal number of quotes or close to equal. And I thought that was my version of objectivity. But I now think that was a terrible move, and I regret doing that, because I think what you need to do is you need to keep the truth as the thing that you are going to convey to your audience. You're not trying to please the Democrats. You're not trying to please the Republicans. You're trying to deliver the truth to your audience. And when Trump threw everything into such a mess by being just a constant liar, it made treating candidates equally really unfair to the truth and unfair to the public.
You know, this is, I want to follow up on this. I think what we'll do right now, we'll grab a very, very quick break. We're going to come back with more of Mark Jacob. I think we're moving into a really interesting area here. So let's grab that break. We'll come right back.
Stop the presses. Forget suggestions. He's not impressed with. So stop the presses. Stop the presses. Stop the presses. Forget suggestions. He's not impressed with. So stop the presses. Stop the presses.
That, of course, is the walk-up music for our guest today. not really, but it's actually the name of his Substack. Mark Jacob writes the weekly newsletter Stop the Presses. Has a long background and a very meritorious background in journalism in the great city of Chicago. We're talking about journalism right now. And yeah, I mean, one of the things that I was kind of pointing at there, Mark, and I think you're pointing at it too, is that the ecosystem has changed. You know, we came out of an era where there were newspapers that operated a certain way, and there was radio, there was television, there were, you know, sort of a predictable set of media. Now, I find myself wondering, I mean, every year there's a Pulitzer given in explanatory journalism. I'm amazed that John Oliver isn't a finalist every year. It seems to me he does more explanatory journalism in the course of what is this kind of arguably a comedy show than most people doing kind of straight-up journalism. I wonder about Heather Cox Richardson, a historian whose Substack has become just this go-to place for breakdown and analysis of the news. I wonder about The View, which is a bunch of people with essentially no journalism credentials who often get very, you know, we'll talk to Pete Buttigieg for 40 minutes or something. I wonder about Pod Save America, a bunch of Obama staffers who are, you know, often analyzing the news, obviously from their point of view, but in a way that I often find very informative. You know, I mean, you know what I'm saying here. It just seems like the ecosystem is different, and we almost have to accept that journalism is sometimes being practiced by people who aren't actually journalists.
Right. I mean, one thing that was, and also all journalists aren't on the, you know, the main platforms. Mm-hmm. And journalists can conduct journalism through Substack newsletters. One thing that was really illustrative to me was, do you remember after the State of the Union address when Katie Britt gave the Republican response and really told a very dishonest story that that required fact-checking? The person who broke that story, and I believe his name is Jonathan Katz, he broke it on TikTok.
Yep.
And to me, that was a real eye-opener that the regular channels, the regular platforms are not always going to be the place where we're going to get our news. And that's not a bad thing. I mean, the internet at its best is democratizing. And it's also a meritocracy. I mean, if some person with 100 followers on Twitter posts something really amazing and it gets, you know, a bunch of likes, follows, whatever, I mean, it can break through. And that never would have happened, you know, in the past, you know, in the decades ago. So that's a great thing, but you also have this monster of social media that's controlled by bad people like Elon Musk, and they're spewing pollution into the atmosphere. It's disinformation. It's not even misinformation, Colin. It's disinformation. They are trying to tell. They're trying to disinform people.
So one of the things that Trump has done lately, on the advice of somebody, is go on a lot of shows that you or I might be unlikely to have heard of that are targeting young men, in particular young men who might not even be super politically engaged. These are hosted by people like with names like Logan Paul, Aiden Ross. Quite recently, he went Lex Fridman would maybe be another example of this type of show, and he did an interview with Fridman that got, I think, at least 5 million views on YouTube alone. He recently made an appearance on a show hosted by Theo Vaughn. The show is called This Past Weekend. It's a podcast. And so he and Trump, a little bit also in the context of Trump talking almost candidly about his brother's alcoholism, they had the following exchange. This is A3 Maestro.
And is that a good feeling? Well,
no.
So it's not even good during what would be normally the good time. In other words, oh, wow. So why would you do it?
I wouldn't. That's why I don't.
That's terrible.
But it's crazy because that's what alcoholism is, I think. It's that it trumps the why.
Yeah.
And you just go to it's like so that's why it's they say that it's cunning, baffling, and powerful. That's what they say about alcoholism.
Yeah.
So I mean, Trump is asking these questions at the beginning about the high from cocaine. Trump, by the way, hung around Studio 54 in its glory days.
Right.
I'm guessing he has some familiarity with how people feel when they're on cocaine, even if he never used it. But it's sort of interesting because, I mean, I watched more of that interview. It got 13 million views in its YouTube forum alone, I'm sure, the podcast platform. That's a lot of people. I mean, you know, shows on sort of primetime MSNBC or CNN or even Fox, 3 to 5 million, you know, that's the, sort of the area you're operating in if you're lucky to clear 3 million. So, you know, that's an interview that might have had a real impact on some people, but it's also well below the radar of the mainstream media. Most of the people who work in the mainstream media don't even know that interview happened or who Theo Vaughn is, which I think also points to the difficulty we have in the in tracking ideas in circulation. But I'd love to get your thoughts.
Well, big subject. I think that Trump really knows his audience. And the scary thing to me, Colin, is that I don't know whether Trump really wants to win. I think that because he doesn't seem – in this whole campaign, he seems to have not tried to broaden his audience at all. It seems like he's just been feeding the same audience he has, his base, which is not enough to win. So, but he's feeding them kind of toxic stuff mostly that will make them think the election was stolen from them and make – you know, cause them to behave in a violent way. So his motives are really hard to figure out, but he's super smart about knowing his audience and knowing how to entertain people and knowing what, you know, hot button issues and stuff like that. And he, you're right. He's bypassed largely the mainstream media too. I mean, that's the fake news to him, but some goofy podcaster who's spewing toxic masculinity is not the fake news. That's the people he goes to. He was on InfoWars, a campaign or two ago, you know, and so he will go anywhere where he thinks there's an audience, which is, I mean, politically smart.
By the way, if you and I could find a big funder, we might be able to take over the InfoWars brand. You know, he's got to sell all that stuff off. We could start InfoWars. We could take over InfoWars and we could do it for good. We could use Alex Jones's creation.
Yeah. That is really, I can't wait to see what happens with that, whether somebody decides that is at least a recognizable brand and then tries to redefine it.
Yeah.
Or somebody who has the same, you know, attitudes as Alex Jones could buy it too.
Right.
And that would be terrible.
You never know with these things. We had, when Joe Lieberman ran for Senate the last time, Ned Lamont had won the Democratic nomination in Connecticut. Lieberman started a party called Connecticut for Lieberman, which I'm pretty sure he never registered with. He just stayed a Democrat. But after he lost interest in it, a bunch of people who were diametrically opposed to his views, far, far to the left of him, took it over and ran Connecticut for Lieberman as a party that did all kinds of things that Joe Lieberman went on. So you never know about this stuff. So, yeah, I mean, I think one of the many differences that you're alluding to when you do these interviews where, you know, the person interviewing you is not necessarily a real journalist, doesn't have the kinds of instincts that you develop over decades if you're a journalist, and maybe doesn't also have a set of standards and practices to which he or she has to adhere to, you have certain advantages, particularly if you're planning not to tell the truth. So let's hear a little bit from the most recent presidential debate. We should say that after the first debate, the debate between Trump and Biden, there was a lot of discontent, including from you, about just the degree to which there was a focus on Biden's age and obvious kind of level of disorientation or whatever you want to call it, and not much of a focus on just the waterfalls of misinformation and just straight out lies told by Donald Trump. So possibly in response to that, here's A4, here's the debate between Harris and Trump.
Crime is down all over the world except here. Crime here is up and through the roof, despite their fraudulent statements that they made. Crime in this country is through the roof. And we have a new form of crime. It's called migrant crime. And it's happening at levels that nobody thought possible.
President Trump, as you know, the FBI says overall violent crime is actually coming down in this country. But
Vice
excuse President
me, the
Harris,
FBI defraud. They were defrauding statements. They didn't include the worst cities. They didn't include the cities with the worst crime. It was a fraud, just like their number of 818,000 jobs that they said they created turned out to be a fraud.
President Trump, thank you. I'll let you respond, Vice President Harris.
Well, I think this is so rich coming from someone who has been prosecuted for national security crimes, economic crimes, election interference, has been found liable for sexual assault, and his next big court appearance is in November at his own criminal sentencing.
So let's tease this apart a little bit. Let's start with Muir fact-checking Trump. You know, this is a thing that's relatively easy to fact-check. You can do it in real time as opposed to waiting for somebody to look stuff up. He says the crime rate's going up, the crime rate's really going down. Pretty easy thing to say. But how do you think that went overall?
Well, it went a lot better for Harris that the ABC people were actually throwing facts at Trump. I mean, the stunning thing about the Trump-Biden debate was that CNN was doing just what I said earlier in this interview. They were just turning the microphones on, and that was it, and asking, you know, questions they'd written, I suppose. But they didn't – I mean, there was one question that they asked Trump in the first debate. They asked him about childcare, and he talked about John Kelly, the FBI, Afghanistan, all this stuff, and he never even touched the subject of childcare. So wasn't it the responsibility of the interviewer, the debate moderator, to say, wait a second, you didn't talk about childcare at all. What are you going to do about childcare? I mean, to push back at least that much, but they didn't. I mean, CNN looked terrible in that debate, and I think ABC learned from it. Now, of course, you have the right wing saying that ABC is terrible and that they've embarrassed themselves. Elon Musk is saying they've lost a lot of credibility, as if he's a moderator of credibility. But I mean, I just feel like that's what you got to do. And it can't be, you know, he said, and Colin, you know, he was saying it was three against one. Well, no, it was the truth against one. It was, because crime is not going up in this country. And no, they didn't leave big cities out of the statistics. That's just a hoax.
That's interesting too, because ABC wasn't ready to fact check that, right? He came back at their fact check with another distortion of fact, which David Muir, I mean, you don't know that's coming. So you're thinking, what, they left things out? Is that true? Have somebody look that up. Well, that's going to take a while. So In a way, Trump has kind of remuddied the waters. And I thought another thing that was interesting about this is that Harris opts out of this whole process with her response. You or I would have said, wait a second, you know, we have to pin this thing down. We have to get to the truth about crime rates and stuff like that. We would have kept going and tried to counter what Trump was doing. Harris has figured out that this is not, for the most part, a game of facts or who's telling the most truth. This is a game of who can get to somebody else, who can get somebody's goat. And so she just starts talking about something she knows will upset him and that he'll be forced to have to spend time and energy responding to. And you know, this is maybe not a good place for the country to be in, Mark, but I think it is the place we're in.
Oh, yeah. And it is amazing that the Harris campaign has figured this out, finally. You know, that just responding to Trump's lies by saying, no, he's lying, doesn't give you a message at all. You end up having no message if your only message is that the other guy's lying. And so she moves on and she talks about things that she wants to talk about. But you can't do that if the moderators won't even bring in any facts. I mean, it is amazing how Trump is able to get the media to operate on his terms, you know, and even in the, you know, we were talking earlier about how all these complaints about Harris not sitting for interviews. But when she does sit for interviews, or she does a little pop-up press conference, you know, outside her limo or something, the questions are all about, hey, here's what Trump said. What's your response? And which is a joke, you know, when in one of these interviews, when Harris was asked about that whole thing about her turning black, which is ridiculous, she just said, just move on. Yeah. She refused to talk for a minute and a half about whether she was black or not.
Right, because otherwise he's living rent free in your brain if you start doing that. So I want to also just talk a little bit, because this is something that you have opined about recently. I mean, one of the ultimate questions here is, who is all this for? All this journalism, all these debates, all these interviews. I mean, Trump's support is hardened off at 47%. You know, it'll move a tick up and down, but not very much. He's like a 47% guy. You know, this looks like kind of a dead heat election, on at least looking at the numbers. Election day will tell some kind of different story. But who is all this for? If 47% of the people will never waver in their support of Donald Trump, no matter what kind of fact-checking is done or what kind of curtain is pulled back to expose his moral puniness or whatever. And you know, Harris's numbers are starting to coalesce in the same way. Who are we doing all this stuff for?
Yeah, well, I've written before about how I feel like the political news media in this country is really entertainment-oriented. Mm. They're not interested enough in informing the public about where people stand on the issues, explaining the issues. They're way more interested in the drama and the narrative of it. They, you know, and that's why they love the polls. That's why, you know, they love the gaffes. That's why they love it when, you know, they just seem to write stories that way. There's an article in the New York Times today about how it's not smart for the Republicans to be bringing up the abortion issue because it's a bad issue for them. Well, that's true. I mean, it's not a terrible article or anything, but it's all framed on, is this smart politics rather than is this smart government or what does this mean to real people? It's all, well, is that a smart political tactic? You know, it's played for sports. You know, it's played as here's this interesting competition that we're watching, and it's and you know, they're in a way that the political news media is entertaining us to death. I mean, because they're not confronting the really scary issues they should be.
It's too bad Neil Postman isn't alive to collect a royalty every time we use that phrase. But I mean, I think also a lot of this is about the idea of the persuadable voter, the undecided voter, whatever you want to call that voter, that if there's 47 on one side and 46 on another, that theoretically means, you know, that there's some group of people who aren't hardened off. And they exist to be persuaded one way or the other. Ron Brownstein has a piece about this in The Atlantic today, but it happens all the time. So, and I know you've done a kind of audio video thing with this, with one of your colleagues about this, but are we over, I think one of you used the word fetishizing the undecided voter.
Yeah, I don't think there are that many undecided voters. I think at this point in time, if you're undecided, you're just not paying any attention. Either that or, I mean, the choices are so stark here, and that I just don't see how you can be undecided unless you're really not paying any attention, you know. And I understand that people are busy, you know, they got to get their kids to soccer practice and stuff. Nobody's, you know, people aren't as much nerds as we are about, you know, the news, mm-hmm. and I don't think that's some sin that they're committing. In fact, you know, I've talked to various people in political messaging and who like will talk about low information voters. And I say, that's a terrible term. It's a stupid term because that puts it on the people. I'd say better to say they're underreached because the news media, for some reason or another, are not reaching them. And that puts it on the news media. So I think that's an important distinction. But I just think that there's all this, the media desperate to find undecided voters. And there've been some embarrassing little mini scandals about that where they find somebody and they call them an undecided voter, but it turns out that they've been, you know, tweeting and posting on Facebook about Trump for 2 years about how much they love him. You know, so finding real undecided voters is extremely difficult. And I think that the news media have overestimated how important that is in the whole narrative. To me, what's really going on here is it's an enthusiasm and turnout play.
Yes, 100%. Jim McLaughlin says that, the Republican pollster Jim McLaughlin says that in Brownstein's piece. These are turnout elections increasingly. It's not a question of who do you like. It's do you care enough to get off the couch and go do that? And how do political professionals and how does journalism play into that whole job of motivating people to vote? Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I mean, that was the big difference between Biden and Harris. Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah.
My daughter is, my older daughter is, I would say, quite liberal. And I was talking to her about it and I was saying, you know, what do you think about Biden and how he's going to do against Trump? And she said, well, if it comes down to it, I'll vote for him, but I just can't do anything for him because he's just too old. He shouldn't be running. And I was thinking, if somebody like that can't get any enthusiasm up for Biden, the Democrats are in big trouble.
Yeah, can I just jump on that for a second?
She has a Kamala Harris sign in her front lawn now.
To that end, I think you make a great point here. Let me just jump on in for a second and ask you this. You know, I think there were a lot of people, I think you were one of them, I to some degree was one of them, who were a little concerned about the level of coverage about Biden's age and his failing faculties. I'm talking pre-July debate, right. You know, and maybe not harping the same way on the fact that Trump makes less and less sense with each passing day. But I wonder about all of this now. I mean, in fact, one could make the case, Mark, that the media helped create the environment where Nancy Pelosi and some other people could persuade Biden to step down, which was something that in the polling, you know, 70-80% of the electorate was saying for a year or more, they thought he was too old. I mean, the thing that's motivating your daughter right now may have been kind of a byproduct of what we thought was an unfairly asymmetric approach to the question of age. But respond to that.
Yeah, well, I didn't really think the news media were unfair by focusing on Biden's age, although, you know, sometimes they went overboard. But what I thought they were unfair about was that they weren't focusing on Trump's age also. Mm-hmm. It became this kind of, you know, they're both really old guys.
Yeah.
And they both slip up in public when they're talking. The thing about it with Biden is Biden has run a rational presidency and Trump ran an extremely scary and irrational presidency. So to me, that's a big difference. They're both old guys, you know, and the news media was for some reason way more focused on Biden than on Trump. I just feel that Trump has trained the news media to have a lower standard for him.
Yeah, and
he's going to say crazy things all the time. And mean things and hateful things. And that's Trump being Trump.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't pass their news bar. You know, it doesn't get over it. So that's what I think's happened with that. So but I think there were some people in the news media vindicated over raising serious questions about Joe Biden.
Yeah.
You know, not that he's run a bad presidency as much as, can you imagine this guy being president, you know, 4.5 years from now?
Right. No, I think Ezra Klein started a process that was really necessary. We got to go to a break here. I do want to say quickly, I do think there's a value proposition issue here, too. I mean, Biden's value proposition was, I'm a competent president. Trump's value proposition is, I'll say whatever comes into my head and people are afraid of me because maybe I'm kind of crazy. So in a way, some of that plays into how they get covered. But we got to take a break. There'll be more of Mark Jacob on the other side. All right, our technical producer today is the maestro, Dylan Reyes. The producer of this episode is the senior producer of the Colin McEnroe Show. That would be Lily Tyson. Our guest is Mark Jacob. He writes the weekly newsletter, which you should be reading and subscribing to, Stop the Presses, former Metro editor of the Chicago Trib, former Sunday editor of the Sun Times. Mark, this hour is going way faster than I thought. We're not going to cover everything I wanted to. I wanted to maybe talk a little bit about sort of specific things going on inside our profession right now. And since I'm sitting here in a public radio studio, let's start with Uri, I think is how he says his name, Uri Berliner, a NPR producer who earlier this year created quite a stir with a piece in the Free Press. He was basically arguing that public radio, which has always had a little bit of a leftish lean, was going way too far, was excluding other points of view. You're very familiar with the critique. What did you make of it, and have you thought anything differently about it since that time?
Well, I mean, NPR's audience is, you know, is fairly, to, you know, left-leaning, I would think. And also, the real interesting thing in the, you know, Trump versus the Democrats thing is the education difference. I mean, if you're a college graduate, you're going to be left-leaning, you know, so that's, you know, most journalists are college graduates, so it's not crazy to think most of them are left-leaning. Now, something that might be even more important than what the frontline reporters do or think is what the owners do and think. You know, and you have right-wing people running major news, owning and running major news outlets. You know, so I think that the whole liberal media thing is mostly a myth. I think that you see a lot of right-wing media in this country, and you see some left-wing media. If you listen to radio in this country, like just regular commercial radio, it's overwhelmingly right-wing. And you know, so this whole, well, the liberal media is telling people what to think is ridiculous, in my opinion.
Yeah, actually, I was for 16 years kind of the house liberal at a CBS-owned radio station that aired Rush Limbaugh and a lot of stuff like that. So I know whereof you speak. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's a bigger subject. Maybe we should tackle it when we have a little bit more time. But I want to talk about another thing that has come up recently, and you've had some things to say about it already. Actually, maybe sort of two things. But let's start with the fairly recent news that Olivia Nuzzi, who's kind of a star political and Washington reporter for New York Magazine, had apparently some kind of relationship, not entirely professional relationship, with Robert F. Kennedy Jr. She's been placed on leave. And it kind of started up a little conversation, too, about ways in which reporters might have not, it's not always going to be an affair. It might be Nina Totenberg being really good friends with Ruth Bader Ginsburg. But can you talk a little bit about how you see all of that?
Well, you know, it was kind of funny because I was a guest on online session for journalists, for young journalists, just a couple of days before the Nuzzi scandal broke. And I gave them a list of do's and don'ts. And the last don't was, don't make friends with politicians. You know, that's not your, you know, that you need to maintain distance. You know, politicians can be charming. You're going to be traveling with them. There might be this impulse to be friends with them. Don't. And if you do, get off of that beat. I mean, the thing about this Olivia Nuzzi thing is that it's not a gray area at all. I mean, if she made the first move, she should have taken herself off the story and, you know, told her editor. If he made the first move, she should have written about it. And if there was a mutual thing with both of them, she needed to go to her editor and say, hey, I can't cover this story anymore. I mean, those are the only three things that should have happened. And they didn't. And one of the things I'm shocked about is that she still has her job. I mean, I'm wondering why New York Magazine has not fired her for this.
Well, because partly, of course, she is kind of a superstar, at least within that world. Another thing that she should have done, and maybe the next time you do one of these sessions, you can recommend this to people, is watch the movie Almost Famous. There's a great scene in which Philip Seymour Hoffman, playing the rock critic Lester Bangs, tells a young journalist named William Miller not to make the mistake that you are just describing. This is B1, Maestro.
Oh, man. You made friends with him. See, friendship is the booze they feed you. Is they want you to get drunk and feeling like you belong.
Well, it was fun.
Because they make you feel cool. And hey, I met you. You are not cool.
I know.
So, you know, I think the other side of this is, so William Miller is writing a piece for Rolling Stone. You know, the editors at Rolling Stone want him to get access. Access is this magical word in journalism, and it means a lot of different things. But, you know, if you have something that's not a purely, you know, you do become friendly with certain people that you're covering, even if maybe they're not your friends. And that could turn into access. And the reality is your editors are probably saying it in one way exactly what you've been saying. Don't become friends. Don't let it get personal and stuff like that. But they're also saying, how come that guy has access?
Yeah.
How come that guy is getting people to talk with him in such an informal way? And you're not. Why don't you have access? But I can hear you want to respond to this.
Well, just look at Stephanie Ruhle. I mean, I'm telling you that the other people in the news industry saw that she went viral on social media for defending Harris, and then, you know, a few days later gets an exclusive interview. That gets noticed in the journalism industry. And so, unfortunately, you'll probably get more people like grandstanding in that way to get that interview. And, you know, I don't disagree with anything that Ruhle said, but I'm saying that's part of the access game. And access will make journalists do the wrong thing. It'll make them pull their punches. It'll make them It'll make them write what we call beat sweeteners, you know, just happy stories about politicians that will, you know, get them in the good graces. And the real problem is what you were saying earlier in the show, that that politicians can pick and choose what they go on and what they don't. They don't, you know, but they don't really need, you know, the CBS as much as they used to. So that's that creates an access problem.
Yeah.
But if you're good journalists need to get past that, and they need to also realize that the politicians in many cases need the journalists as much as the journalists need the politicians.
Absolutely. But I will just give a fairly benign example. So John McCain, I think in 08, had that, maybe he always did this. He had this thing where there'd be an open seat next to him on his campaign bus if he was doing stump speeches and stuff like that. And a different journalist would be picked on a given day to sit in. And who doesn't want that, right? Who doesn't?
Right.
And McCain was very smart, or somebody was very smart on that campaign who thought, yeah, let's make this incredible informal access privilege available to journalists X, Y, or Z. And I don't know that there's any way to opt out of that that particular game, Mark. This will probably be our final exchange. We're running out of time here.
No, I agree with that. But this also, another thing this plays into is the whole idea of you see the same people on TV news shows all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, you see Tom Cotton and you see Lindsey Graham. It's because they're willing to go on, and it's easy for the programmers to have them on. Why don't TV news shows go find unusual people to interview? Find somebody who's working on Medicaid in some rural county in Kentucky. You know, I mean, because, you know, why the answer, Colin, is because that's hard work.
Yep.
You know, and calling Lindsey Graham's press flack is easy work.
Yeah, I mean, these people, that's the other part of it. They are ready to go. And they know what they're going to say, and you don't have to beat the bushes to find them. Mark Jacob, it's been fascinating talking to you and be able to devote a whole show to it. Mark Jacob writes the weekly newsletter, Stop the Presses. You should be reading this newsletter. Very, very interesting. He is the former Metro editor of the Chicago Trib, former Sunday editor of the Chicago Sun-Times, co-author of 10 books on history and photography. I hope you're enjoying this series. We should come up with a catchy name for it, but we don't seem to be able to do that. But it is our attempt to get one person and talk in some depth about one single aspect of the campaign. We'll be doing another one next week, but we're not ready to reveal it yet. Geraldo Rivera is going to reveal the identity of the next guest. You know the story.